Though the tears may fall, my song will rise to you. Though my heart may fail, my song will rise to you. While there's breath in my lungs, I will praise you, Lord. In the dead of night, I'll lift my eyes to you. Though the waters rise, I'll lift my eyes to you. While there's hope in this heart, I will praise you.
The darkness out. And everybody hear me. Let's open up in prayer to begin the study, shall we? Jesus, thank you for this time we can gather together, open up your word. May you open up our minds and our hearts to really understand what you have to share with us tonight, Father. Thank you for Roman's willingness to lead us into another installment of Christian Resolutions study and fruit of the Spirit. I pray that you would really enrich our hearts and minds and help us get as we have never even thought possible out of word tonight.
Okay, can you hear me now? All right, I apologize for that. Let's try this again, shall we? I don't know how that, I have a toggle switch, the F4 key, which turns my microphone off. I have no reason to ever go near it. And it was toggled off for some reason. Thank you for Christwalk for saying that you have your mic off somewhere. So we found it. We are continuing in our review and examination of joy, the second named fruit of the Spirit, as a facet and offshoot, as that should read, of our primary series, Christian Resolutions 2020. The Bible has many things to say regarding joy, and I give full credit to the Tori's Bible textbook, sharing with you some of the verses it lists under the heading, Joy of the Saints. Following many of these verses, I'll be adding the commentary of Matthew Henry and other commentators. And our first stop tonight is found in the Gospel where we read in John 16:33, Jesus saying, "These things I have spoken unto you, that in me ye might have peace. In the world ye shall have tribulation, but be of good cheer. I have overcome the world." And of this, Matthew Henry writes, "The divine nature did not desert the human nature, but supported it and put comfort and value into Christ's sufferings. And while we have God's favorable presence, we are happy and ought to be easy, though all the world forsake us. Peace in Christ is the only true peace, and in him alone believers have it. Through him we have peace with God, and so in him we have peace in our own mind. We ought to be encouraged because Christ has overcome the world before us. But while we think we stand, let us take heed lest we fall. We know not how we should act if brought into temptation. Let us watch and pray without ceasing, that we may not be left to ourselves." And to that, the Sermon Bible adds, "There is a difficulty in seizing the precise meaning of the word world. It seems an airy, subtle, impalpable thing, but the world of St. John. It refuses to be described, to be precipitated, to be measured, to be defined. It's not the wicked, though they are its victims. It's not Satan, though the scriptures call him its prince, as presiding over it and then rejoicing in it. It's an atmosphere, a temper, a spirit, a power real and most energetic, but dread and invisible. It has hung for ages, this world, like a dark, murky cloud over the heart of humanity. It poisons the very air we breathe. It is that warp in the aim and affections of the soul, which makes of each of the subjects of this invisible creation and of the circumstances of life a distinct hindrance to get to heaven. Let us note the character of its influence." First of all, it works secretly and without being suspected. Observe the language which we use with regard to it in daily life. When we speak of the world, we uniformly assume that it is something outside us. The world disguises itself. It's like Satan showing himself in the character of an angel of light. It seems to be habitually respectable. It dislikes gross sin. It affects very particularly to cultivate the social virtues. It can be prudent, like the old prophet. It can be wise, like Ahithophel. It can be courageous, as was Saul. It can be very pious, indeed, like the false prophets of the church at Corinth. Number two, the world has a marvelous versatility. There may be a difference of form. There's a marvelous and awful unity of spirit. The spirit of the world is contagious. It passes like an infection from soul to soul. Number three, what was the relation of our Lord to the Jewish world in his day and generation? It could not receive his spirit. It rejoiced at his departure. It rested not, that world, till it had led him to the cross. And therefore his resurrection was not merely a conquest of death, not merely the crowning proof of his divinity. It was a triumph over the power that had killed him. It was the conquest of the world. Be of good cheer, he said, in full view of his Easter triumph. I have overcome the world. And that's from H.P. Lydon, from a book called The Penny Pulpit. But let's read John 16:33 again to keep it fresh in our minds, to see the whole verse as it appeared. These things I have spoken unto you, that in me ye might have peace. In the world ye shall have tribulation, but be of good cheer. I have overcome the world. And then the commentary continues, there is clearly a negative rolled up in this sentence. It's this, that there is no peace out of Christ. Number one, let's be careful that we understand what the peace of God is. It's the feeling of being forgiven, a quiet conscience, a stilling sense of the love of God. That's the first thing. Then growing out of that, it is a certain contemplative habit of mind that deals silently with unseen things, which lives up high enough not to be tossed and anxious much about the matters which concern the present world. For it is the repose of faith, a trust in promises, a sense of a Father's love, a Father's nearness, a Father's care, the hush of a little child leaning on his bosom. Number two, it is of immense importance to have that peace, because one, first, it is the sweetest and the best and the only satisfying of all possessions. It meets the deepest longings of a man's heart. Pleasure is a man's delight, but peace is man's necessity. No man is complete till he has peace. No man knows what he can be, the capabilities of his own nature, or what enjoyment is, till he is at peace. And the violinist says, maybe it's just me, but a lot of the preaching nowadays seems to be in a way geared to what people's itching ears want to hear. Too often it doesn't help us learn or provoke us towards godly living like it used to around 100 years ago. A violinist, I could not agree more. You say, maybe it's just me. It is not just you. When I say I thank God that these men recorded these sermons and these commentaries 100 and longer years ago, I mean that, because we are not being fed this way anymore. We're just not. Number two, peace is the root of all holiness. To believe that you are pardoned, to be at leisure from the retrospect, to carry a conscience at ease, to take the unruffled reflection of Christ, even as Christ did of the Father. That is the atmosphere of a daily religious life, and that is the secret of every good thing. Number three, peace is the fulfillment of the work of Christ. Then the eloquence of the cross has not been in vain. Then his word has accomplished its grand design. And again, quote, these things have I spoken unto you, that in me ye might have peace. Number three. Three rules for peace. Number one, be more decided. Decision is the parent of peace. Take some steps at once heavenward, and it may be that one step will land you in peace. Number two, confess Christ. Confess him in the world. Do not be ashamed of your better portion. Begin to speak of Christ to somebody. And lastly, go up and down more in Christ, his work, his person, his beauty, his grace. Listen for his still small voice. He will speak. You will hear him and you will feel him. A strange grand reality. A thing that comes and does not go away again, like everything else. Peace. And that's from Jay Vaughan, from a book called Sermons from 18, check it out, violinist, 1868. And we're not being treated to that kind of teaching and preaching. Yeah, 3 years after the Civil War. In the world ye have tribulation. Such is our cry when we think of the thousand pains and miseries which we have endured in the year that's gone. When we remember the labor and trouble that we have passed through, eating our bread in the sweat of our brow, sighing under the burden and heat of the day. These are but our own troubles, and life would be an easy thing if each had only his own burden to bear, if the manifold grief of others did not also lie heavy on our hearts. Number one, what was the tribulation of which the Lord speaks in the words of our text? A new divine life had sprung up for the disciples and their Redeemer. A life which the world neither possessed nor understood. They were to bring that life to the world. And the world was hostile to them. Not only was it unwilling to receive the life of God, but it would not even listen to the story of that life. It had no heart for the love which God had shown it. No eye for the truth of grace which shone upon it in darkness. So the disciples had tribulation in the world. And their tribulation is ours also. We feel that this is a world of sin. We know the terrible power with which sin rules in the world at large, and in the little world which each man carries within him. Number two, be of good cheer, says the Lord. I have overcome the world. He who speaks thus was no idle spectator of our sorrow, but one who himself fought a battle such as none ever fought before or since. At the very moment when his fiercest conflict was about to begin, he calls to us in these words from the clear, joyous heights in which his being had its home. And was not the battle he fought the fiercest ever engaged in? He bore in himself the contest as never did before. There was not one moment of defeat during all that conflict. He was victor from first to last. The fiercer the battle, the more glorious was his victory. And the glorified victor calls now to us, be of good cheer. I've overcome the world. For him who follows, the world has overcome already. This is the victory that overcometh the world, even our faith. The next thing that Tori's textbook shows us is that we have joy for the hope of glory, from Romans 5:1. Therefore, being justified by faith, we have peace with God through our Lord Jesus Christ, by whom also we have access by faith into this grace wherein we stand and rejoice in hope of the glory of God. Matthew Henry writes of this: a blessed change takes place in the sinner's state when he becomes a true believer, whatever he has been. Being justified by faith, he has peace with God. The holy, righteous God cannot be at peace with a sinner. The holy, righteous God cannot be at peace with a sinner while under the guilt of sin. Justification takes away the guilt and so makes way for peace. This is through our Lord Jesus Christ, through him as the great peacemaker, the mediator between God and man. The saint's happy state is a state of grace. Into this grace we are brought, which teaches that we are not born in this state. We could not have got into it of ourselves, but we are led into it as pardoned offenders. Therein we stand, a posture that denotes perseverance. We stand firm and safe, upheld by the power of the enemy. And those who have hope for the glory of God hereafter have enough to rejoice in now. In order to more fully incorporate the occasion of joy in Scripture and our examination of it, understanding that where there is joy, there is rejoicing, as we just saw. We read first in Psalms 13:5, "But I have trusted in thy mercy. My heart shall rejoice in thy salvation." Albert Barnes writes of this: "But I have trusted in thy mercy, in thy favor, thy friendship, thy promises." His original confidence had been in God only and not in himself. That confidence he still maintained, and now, as the result of that, he begins to exult in the confidence that he would be safe. The idea is, I have trusted in the mercy of God, I still trust, and I will trust forever. My heart shall rejoice in thy salvation. The word salvation here does not refer to salvation in the future world, but to deliverance from his present troubles, or to God's interposition in putting him into a condition of safety. The idea is that he had entire confidence that God would interpose, and that there would yet be cause to rejoice in that salvation as actually accomplished. He now calls on his heart to rejoice in the assurance that it would be his. So with us, not only be rejoicing in salvation when actually accomplished, but there may and should be in the firm conviction that it will be ours. John Gill adds to this: "But I have trusted in thy mercy." The faith, hope, and comfort of the psalmist grew and increased prayer. From complaining, he goes to praying. From praying to believing. He trusted not in himself, not in his own heart, nor in his own righteousness and merit, but in the mercy of God. And not in the bare absolute mercy of God, but in the grace and goodness of God, as the world, as the word here used signifies, as it is displayed in the plenteous redemption which is by Christ. Sufficient ground of faith and hope. My heart shall rejoice in thy salvation, which God is the contriver, author, and giver of, and in which the glory of his perfection is so greatly displayed. And a true believer is more on account that God is glorified by it than because of his own interest in it. And this joy is an inward one. It is joy in the heart, and is real and unfeigned, and is what continues and will be felt and expressed both here and hereafter. And the violinist writes, when you bring your Bible study to us each week, I become aware and more and immense spiritual gold and jewels that are without number in the Word. All that needs to be done to find such treasures is to dig for it. Amen. That's what I've been saying for years. And the more you dig, richer you get. You can't not get richer the more you dig. John Gill provides a cross-reference to Psalm 130 and verse 7, which says, let Israel hope in the Lord, for with the Lord there is mercy, and with him is plenteous redemption, to which he comments. The psalmist, having himself hope in the Lord, and in his word, through a view of forgiveness with him, exhorts and encourages others to do so likewise. Even every Israelite indeed, and such may be comfortable hope in him for salvation, which was designed, contrived, promised, and now wrought out for sinners, the chief of sinners, and to be had freely. And the gospel declaration is that whosoever believes in Christ shall be saved, as well as for the remission of sin, which God has promised in covenant, proclaimed in Christ whom he has sent to obtain it, and exalted to give it, and has declared in the gospel that whoever believes in him shall have it, and also for eternal life and happiness, which is the gift of God through Christ, is in the hands of Christ, and of which the Spirit is the earnest and the pledge. For with the Lord there is mercy, which is natural and essential to him, as displayed is either general and over all his works and toward all his creatures, or special, only shown to whom he will. This flows through Christ, and is very large and abundant, and appears in various instances in the covenant and the mission of Christ, and redemption by him, in regeneration, the forgiveness of sins, and in salvation. And with him is plenteous redemption. The purpose of it was in him. The scheme of it was drawn by him. The covenant of it was made with him. The promise of it was published. And now the thing itself is done, and is with Christ the author of it. And this is plenteous if we consider the number of persons redeemed from among men, being such as no man can number. What of them is redeemed? Even all of them? Neither soul, even all of them, their souls and body. What they've redeemed from all sin, the law, curse, and condemnation, from death and hell, from Satan and all enemies. The several blessings included in it or connected with it: pardon of sin, justification of person, adoption, sanctification, and eternal life. Great price paid for it: the blood, the life of Christ, yea, himself, and the large display of love, grace, and mercy, wisdom, power, godliness made in it. Another occasion of rejoicing in the Psalms: for our heart shall rejoice in him because we have trusted in his holy name. John Gill writes of this: for our heart shall rejoice in him, not in sin, nor in themselves, in their boastings, all such rejoicing is evil, but in the Lord, in his word, as the Targum is, in the essential word of God, Christ Jesus, in his person, righteousness, and salvation. And this joy is heart joy, inward joy, real joy, joy in the Holy Ghost, and is unspeakable and full of glory. This is what the psalmist calls upon the saints to do in the beginning of the psalm, and so his end in composing it is answered. And now the phrase, because we have trusted in his holy name. That is, in himself, who is holy, just, and good, and so faithful to every word of promise, to every engagement of his, and therefore to be trusted in. And hence it appears that the joy before spoken of is the joy of faith. In the New Testament, we read of joy and rejoicing, 10:17 and verse 20. Luke 10:17, and that should say, and verse 20. I'll fix that. And the 70 returned again with joy, saying, Lord, even the devils subject unto us through thy name. And then verse 20, notwithstanding, in this rejoice not that the spirits are subject unto you, but rather rejoice because your names are written in heaven. Alexander McLaren writes, the return of the 70 soon followed their being sent forth. They came back with a childish, surprised joy, and almost seemed to have thought that Jesus would be as much astonished and excited as they were with the proof of the power of his name. They had found that they could not only heal the sick, but cast out demons. Jesus' answer is meant to quiet down their excitement by teaching them that he had known what they were doing whilst they were doing it. Gifts and powers are good and may legitimately be rejoiced in, but to possess eternal life and to belong to the mother city of us all, the New Jerusalem, is better than all gifts and all power. Uh, A name written on earth implies that the bearer of the name belongs to earth, and is also secondarily suggests that the inscription lasts but for a little while. Contrarywise, a name written in heaven implies that its bearer belongs to heaven, and that the inscription will abide. We find running throughout Scripture the metaphor of books in which men's names are. Moses thought of a book which God has written and in which his name was enrolled. The psalmist speaks of the book of the living, and Isaiah of those who are written among the living in Jerusalem. Ezekiel threatens the prophets who speak lies in Jehovah's name. They shall not be written in the writing of the house of Israel. The Apocalypse has many references to the book, which is designated as the Lamb's Book of Life, and which is opened at the final judgment along with the books in which each man's life history is written. And only they who are written in the Lamb's Book of Life enter into the city that comes down out of heaven. In the New Testament, the Book of Life is called the Lamb. We are led to think of Christ as writing it, and hence of our faith in him as being the condition of enrolling our names. The names written on earth are swiftly obliterated, like a child's scrawl on the sand, which is washed away by the next tide, or covered up by the next storm that blows about the sandhill. What a contrast is that of the names written on the heavens, high up above all earth creation. In one sense, oblivion soon seizes on us all. In another, none of us is ever forgotten by God, but good and bad alike live in his thought. Still, this idea of a special remembrance has place, as suggesting that, however unnoticed or forgotten on earth, God's children live in the true golden book. Their names are in the Book of Life. We read again of rejoicing in the Psalms, where we have joy for divine support. In Psalm 63 and verse 7, because thou hast been my help, therefore in the shadow of thy wings I. Of this, Matthew Henry writes, God strengthens us and comforts us. Messiah the Prince shall rejoice in God. He has already entered into the set before him, and his glory will be completed at his second coming. Blessed Lord, let our desire toward thee increase every hour. Let our love be always upon us. Be thou all in all to us while we remain in the present wilderness state, and bring us home to the everlasting enjoyment of thee forever. Back again in the New Testament, and I will correct this before I post it, to put the Psalms all together and the New Testament all together. Let's notice what the Apostle Paul wrote in 1 Corinthians 12, verses 25 and 26. There should be no schism in the body, but that the members should have the same care one for another. And whether one member suffer, all the members suffer with it. or one member be honored, all the members rejoice with it. John Gill adds, oh, here we are. Matthew Henry writes of this. The members of the natural body are made to have care and concern for each other, to prevent a schism in it. So should it be in Christ's body. The members should sympathize with each other. As in the natural body, the pain of one part afflicts the whole. The ease and pleasure of one part affects the whole. And so should Christians reckon themselves honored in the honors of their fellow Christians and should suffer in their suffering. Note, Christian sympathy is a great branch of Christian duty. We should be so far from slighting our brethren suffering that we should suffer with them, and so far from envying their honor that we should rejoice with them and reckon ourselves honored in them. And now we get to John Gill's comment. All the members suffer with it, are more or less affected therewith, and bear part of the distress, as is easily discerned by their different forms and motions on such an occasion. So when any one member of the mystical body is in affliction, whether inward or outward, of body or mind, the rest are, or should be, affected with, condole, sympathize, help, and assist. And remember them that are in bonds as bound with them, as if they themselves were in bonds, and them that suffer adversity, whether spiritual or temporal, as being in the body, not only in the flesh, but as being part of the body, the church, and therefore should weep with them that weep, and bear a part of them, and bear a part with them in their sorrows. All the members rejoice with it as sharing in the honor or benefit of it. So if one member of the Church of Christ is honored with an high honor, with great gifts, large measure of grace, spiritual light, knowledge and experience, with great discoveries of the love of God, with the presence of Christ, with the communion of the Holy Ghost, or with the good things of this, and in heart to make use of them for the interests of religion, the other members rejoice at it. For so it becomes the saints to rejoice with them and be glad both at the temporal and spiritual prosperity of each other. And upon the whole, it is clear that the meanest have no reason to be discouraged, nor the highest and great to be proud and elated. As we continue in Tory's listing of joy, we come to the believer's joy is unspeakable. Speaking of Jesus, we read in 1 Peter 1 and verse 8, whom having not seen, ye love, in whom though now ye see him not, yet believing, ye rejoice with joy unspeakable and full of glory. Matthew Henry writes, joy in God is of great consequence in the Christian life, and Christians need to be again and again called to it. It more than outweighs all causes for sorrow. The peace of God, the comfortable sense of being reconciled to God and having a part in His favor and the hope of the heavenly blessedness are a greater good than can be fully expressed. This peace will keep our hearts and minds through Christ Jesus. It will keep us from sinning under troubles and from sinking under them. Keep us calm and with inward satisfaction. Believers are to get and to keep a good name, a name for good things with God. We should walk in all the ways of virtue and abide therein. And lastly, as we conclude our review and examination of joy, we're admonished in 1 Thessalonians 5:16, rejoice evermore. Of this, Matthew Henry comments, we are to rejoice in creature comfort as if we rejoice not, and must not expect to live many years and rejoice in them. But if we do rejoice in God, we may do that evermore. A truly religious life is a life of constant joy, and we should rejoice more if we prayed more. Prayer will help forward all lawful business and every good work. Excuse me. I think the pollen count must be up. If we pray without ceasing, we shall not want matter for the thanksgiving and everything. We shall see cause to give thanks for sparing and preventing, for common and uncommon, past and present, temporal and spiritual mercy, not only for prosperous and pleasing, but also for afflicting providence, for chastisements and correction. For God designs all for our good. And as some of you may have guessed, I was just about to say, this includes the season's discussion, Christian Resolutions 2020, Part 17. Next week, God willing, we will be continuing in Paul's list of the fruit of the Spirit to the third named fruit, peace. I hope as many of you who are here or reading these